when you're put into jail, your tolerance goes way down. And we don't have any reason to believe, generally speaking, that jail is going to make somebody better, that it's going to cure their addiction. There's a high likelihood that they're going to go and pick up and start using again, at which point their tolerance is going to be much lower, and they have a much higher likelihood of overdosing at that point. So how do we fix this? You know, this is a system that's pretty well ingrained in our, you know, in our culture. Like, how do we fix this? How do we turn this around? I'd like to take a look at another country that's taken a different approach. So Portugal was the first country. There's like seven countries now that have decriminalized drug use. Portugal was the first one to do it in 2001. These are some stats from Johann Hari's book, as well as a couple from the Washington Post. So if we talk about decriminalizing drugs in America, the initial reaction, the knee-jerk reaction is, you know, this is going to cause huge problems. More people are going to use, more kids are going to use, more people are going to die. If we look at statistics from Portugal, just the opposite has happened. So since 2001, well, in 2001, adults between the age of 15 and 64, close to 5% of adults had indicated that they had used drugs at some point in their lives. In 2015, that number was below 2%. And when you look at those numbers of the people that had used drugs in their life, prior to 2001, 45% of the people that had used drugs did so on a continuing basis. Today, that number is close to 25%. It's almost half of that number. So, you know, making drugs or decriminalizing drugs isn't going to, you know, turn the world upside down. If we look at the way that prohibition worked for alcohol, it did exactly what the deputy was talking about. You know, it turned criminals, or turned people into criminals. People amassed arsenals, and you know, we know what, you know, we've all seen gangster movies, we know what the 1920s were like, and that was a very real response to alcohol prohibition. The same thing's going on, you know, in the drug war today. There are people making huge amounts of money off this because of the, you know, the legal status of it. There's cartels that are stacking bodies up every day along our borders. So, in Portugal, prior to 2001, there were more than 100 deaths in the city of Lisbon. In 2015, there were less, or there were 12 deaths. There were 12 deaths in 2015. So the number of overdose deaths has decreased significantly also. And that's not just to do with decriminalization. You can't just believe because they decriminalized drugs that overdoses have gone down. But since they decriminalized drugs, their attitude towards drug use has changed as well. So access to harm reduction services, like the ones that we provide at the Red Project, has increased drastically. So that, you know, attitudes like that have played a large role in why those overdose numbers have gone down so far. So basically, in summary, I guess, it's my feeling that we really need to stop putting money, as much money, into criminal justice approach towards drug use and starting putting more money into, you know, mental health and social justice reform. We need to start treating this as a public health issue that it is and stop locking people up. So, you know, the next time an election comes around and you're looking at who to vote for, I really encourage you to, you know, ask these questions, ask how they feel about these things, because these things aren't going to change without a significant shift in momentum of how we're treating this problem. And I don't believe that the way that we've been treating it up till now has been successful.
Thank you. Judge Craig Bunt to speak on sobriety court as a new approach.
All right. Well, first of all, I brought along a brochure for the sobriety treatment program, and on the front of our brochure it says, saving lives, reuniting families, and improving communities. And first off, I just want to say thank you for being here, because you're sharing what we're trying to do through Sobriety Corps. By being here, you're getting yourself informed on what's out there, what services are out there, and what you can do to help those in need. And so thank you for your time being here. I am Judge Craig Bonds. I sit in the 58th District Court here in Grand Haven, just a block over here. And before that position, I was an assistant prosecutor in the county for about 18 years. And back in 2004, I was allowed to be part of a sobriety treatment court start or kickoff there in Holland District Court. And it's a team approach to those that are in addiction, and specifically with alcohol addiction. And so as the prosecutor on the team, I had certain responsibilities that I brought to the table. And as I went through that career with Sobriety Treatment Court out of Holland, I knew that it had benefits that worked. it had benefits for single moms whose kids didn't get to see who their mom really was when she was in the throes of addiction. I mentioned to someone here earlier tonight that I remember specifically one graduation ceremony where the 8-year-old daughter got up and said, "I no longer have to fix the frozen dinner for my younger siblings anymore. Mom is able to make us dinner tonight." You know, a mom who, during the program, became pregnant, and we were able to actually document that there was no alcohol on board during the life of that term of that pregnancy. Significant cost savings to the community as a result, but making a whole family when that child was born for having a mom who could now deal with her addiction in a healthy way. So what has Ottawa County done then, at least the Ottawa County courts done in regard to addiction? Specialty treatment courts have kind of hit the forefront, and Ottawa County was early on involved in that process. As I said, 2004 was the first sobriety court program in the Holland District Court. And actually both judges down there, Judge Kunal and Judge Jonas, started a docket that can hold up to 35 people. And that docket is to be focused around people with convicted of drunk driving second offenses. It's about a 17-month program. That's about the earliest you can get through the program. And it's really a team approach where probationers need to come in on a regular basis to see the judge, be reviewed to see how their progress has gone in the program, whether they've had any slips, whether they have some joys to share amongst the group. We have about those 35 participants. We have them in the courtroom during review session, and so they get to see how their fellow participants are doing in the program. And kind of the group mentality, the group therapy model, we get some benefits from that, working in that way. When I became a judge back, I started on the bench in 2013, I had always had in my mind that it was great that we had these two courts down in Holland, but when you have a drunk driving second, one of the first things you lose is your driver's license. So how do the people in the northern part of the county get access to this program that I thought was working pretty darn well? And I checked around with our staff, and we said, let's start a program up here. And so now we have a docket here in the Grand Haven District Court that began in 2014, and we carry about 35, sometimes 40-ish people in the program at any one time, and work them through that same process. In addition to the sobriety treatment courts, we have a couple other specialty courts in Ottawa County. In 2014, Judge Kunal started a mental health treatment court out of the Holland District Court, and that's to help those who are suffering or dealing with mental illness and are involved in crime. And we don't want to just, as Jonathan indicates, lock them up. We want to provide the assistance that's there to keep them on their therapy plan, to build support around their family module so that they can live a healthy life as they go through the system. So that works out of the Holland District Court, and unfortunately, because of the way we work amongst our courts, I'm able to actually sentence into the mental health court if there is a person here that fits the qualifications and needs that program. We also have a sobriety treatment court program or a drug court program at our circuit court level. Judge Fine operates that program and has for many years. Fortunately, some good news, and I don't want to steal Priscilla's thunder here, but just some good news. There was some extra funding that was received, and instead of a one docket program, that's going to be split into a two docket program. One of the dockets is going to be separated into just a drunk driving third offense conviction that results you in being placed in that program. The other docket will be focused on the other drug addictions. So some more specialized care can be given in those two dockets in that way. But more importantly than that, it doubles the size of how many people we can deal with and treat through that program. So we're glad to be venturing off into that new expanded program. I want to give you just an idea of how the sobriety treatment courts in Michigan, how does Ottawa County stack up against the other sobriety treatment courts? Well, it should never be about data. Sometimes we want to make sure we're doing the right thing to keep us on track, that our therapy module works. And so we look at how we're doing as opposed to other courts across the state. If we look at any recidivism, and recidivism here I'll indicate is any alcohol or drug conviction within 4 years of entry into our program. So that's the group that we're looking at. In Ottawa County, we have a 5% recidivism rate. On the state average, we have a 9% recidivism rate. So we're doing pretty well here, fortunately. Knock on wood, we want that to continue. convictions, now this will be any conviction, within a 4-year period of entry into a program. Ottawa County recidivism rate is 8%. Statewide average is 13%. So again, we're at least meeting the bar and doing a little bit better than that, and we're glad to see that. And that's because we do have a lot of dedicated people that work through our probation staff that spend unknown amounts of hours with our participants in our programs to help them create a better life for themselves and their families. A lot of times it's also just to be a voice. We hear about bonding earlier in the first comments, and really that's what it takes. You know, addiction is there, it needs to be dealt with, but it's a behavioral change, a long-term change in order to keep it in place. And if we can build a safe family, a strong structure, a disciplined structure of behavior, and that's what we try to encourage through the sobriety treatment courts, we think that we can continue to set at least the ball in motion for a healthy family and community as a result. So that's what we're doing in the court system. If you'd ever like to take part in seeing some of our courtroom activities, are open to the public. We'd love to have you come in, sit, and see what a review session looks like. And if you have questions, I know any one of the judges that handle any of those specialty treatment courts would love to sit and talk with you about any questions that you might have. But again, thank you for coming on.
Thank you, Judge Bunce. Move to Dan Qualls, an addiction therapist, to speak about the need of including family and peers in recovery.
Sure. Hello. Although it doesn't look possible because I look so young, I actually started in the field in 1977. I started in the field in 1977, but my exposure to addiction was much earlier than that because I grew up in an addicted family. And so as I came up, you know, developed a lot of those attitudes, a lot of that stuff that surrounded it, and eventually ended up with a whole host of addictions myself. In 77, though, interestingly enough, I started in the field as an attempt to cure my own addiction. I didn't get clean and sober myself until 1982. And I bring that up in part because I want to focus some of the comments specific to opiates